I built an AI-powered Chrome extension. How it works is you click a button on any given web page, it extracts the data from that page, it'll summarize it for you, and then answer any questions about any details that you have to ask. It also adds it to my own personal knowledge base, so it's like having my own conversational encyclopedia at my fingertips. You open it up in the browser and hit the Extract Page Content button. It extracts the content from whatever page you're on, and the bot sends you a message briefing you on the contents of the web page. From there, you can converse about the page, ask questions, extract specific details, and if the info changes at any point, you can just re-scrape the web page by hitting the scrape button. Your conversations are cross-referenced with URLs, so you can always continue where you left off. It's pretty cool, honestly, nothing mind-blowing. Botpress already has built-in features for different deployment channels, so I didn't technically have to go to the trouble of making my own client. They also implement web search, so you don't need to be on a page to access its content. The real reason I wanted to show you was this, the code I used to build it. This is a full front-end Chrome extension. It uses the Botpress client library, webhook API calls, real-time updates, local storage, error handling, you name it. Disclosure, by the way, I base it on this template. You should go check it out. I built this because prototyping bots is easy, and deploying them is easy if you use one of the supported communication channels or the React library. Like, I was able to embed the web chat code into HTML or, you know, build some React boilerplate. But then what if I wanted to build a full-on app with persistence, user data, hooks, custom bot behavior, multiple entry points, callbacks? It got a little overwhelming, so I built this. Here's how it works in a nutshell. The app manages conversation state between your Botpress account and the extension's storage. The extension automatically saves conversation states, and when you navigate to a page, it looks through your history to see if you've already scraped that page. This is all local, by the way. We're just talking about the front end here. The tricky thing here is that it's hitting the conversation from two different endpoints, the chat API and the webhook API. I needed to manage the conversation state inside the extension so that the conversation that you're speaking in is the same one where the content is. So if you scrape the data from a page and then ask questions about it, the bot that's answering you is the same bot that has access to the web content that you just extracted. So to set up the extension locally, you gotta go here to GitHub, and we wanna clone the repo. Now we wanna install the dependencies. Cool, done. And now build it. Great, now let's go to our browser, extensions. Make sure you're in developer mode. And we wanna load unpacked. You're gonna find your way to the repo, and you wanna load the build folder. I'm gonna pin it just for testing. And here's the configuration page. So now let's talk about setting up the Botpress bot to be able to work with this extension. So here's the bot that I use with the extension. Depending on what you're going to do with this extension, your bot can take one of many different forms. And in fact, you'll see right here that I have two different flows that I use. Both of these interface perfectly fine with the bot. It'll just change depending on the types of websites you're using and the type of information you might want to take. So to start off, we're going to install the proper integrations. The ones that we need for this bot are chat and webhook. The chat integration comes with the webhook URL. Don't confuse that with the webhook URL that we're gonna use for the webhook integration. For now, we wanna copy that, and to configure the integration, put that right here. Oops, okay, sorry, we just need the ID. My bad. Cool, worked. The next thing that we need is if we wanna enable scraping, we have to configure a webhook URL. So where do we get that? You go over here to the webhook trigger. By the way, if you wanna create a new one of these, right click, trigger, webhook event. I'm gonna delete this. This will only be available if you have the webhook integration installed. Right here. So what we do is we grab the URL. This is a separate URL from the chat integration. We copy that. And here, paste that here, webhook URL. And now we save that. We make sure the connection's running. Cool, rock and roll. Now's the part where we check out how to build a Botpress flow that works with the format that our extension works in. So as you can tell, we have two different flows. I'm gonna clean this up a bit. Two different flows because I wanna show you two different ways you can make this app work. So we're gonna go through the first one here first. When I'm on a page and I hit the extract page content button, what's gonna happen is the webhook event is going to be fired. It is going to go through this flow to the browse pages card. Now the browse pages card goes into the webhook event and it's gonna grab the URL and it's going to scrape the URL and then save that in here, workflow.searchResult. I'm going to show you in my logs up here how I'm accessing that. This is the body of the request that we get from the extension. It has content extracted, that's a formality, and then has the type of content that we have, the domain, a bunch of other stuff. It has the conversation ID. That's important. We'll come back to that. Also important, it has the URL. Now, the URL here is the value that's being passed to the browse pages card. As you can tell over here, event payload body data, page content URL. It's a little bit of a mouthful. What happens is that information gets saved, and then this is what the content looks like. It kind of looks like a mess here, but it's very machine readable, which is what's important. This all gets passed to the autonomous node. So let's go through the instructions that I give to the node to be able to hold the conversation. So if I'm on this page, I scrape it. What was his first role? And it gives his first role. The other entry point that we get here is through the start. When I send a message, it follows the start flow and goes through here. Now I can go to any website and start a new conversation. And as you can see, it's gonna answer based on the fact that I don't have content, because as we'll see in the instructions soon, it is geared towards talking about web page content. But if I enter through the chat entry point, then it hasn't actually gone through the webhook flow. So let's have a look at what this autonomous node does. And by the way, for those who are unfamiliar, an autonomous node is this wrapper that deals with tool calling, accesses variables, set variables, and also deals with the conversational layer all in one instruction set. So I'm going to walk you through what these instructions are. You're a helpful website assistant. Your purpose is to chat with users about the contents of a web page, answering any potential questions they have about it. Assume that inquiries are pertinent to the web page in question and focus primarily on addressing that. Keep in mind that the user is using you to summarize content and extract key information. You should aim to keep answers brief and to the point. So what I'm getting at basically is just priming the LLM to understand that this is going to be a conversation about the web page. If it doesn't have the context, then it should hint you for it or ask you for it. But more importantly, once it has that context, it should assume that whatever you're saying to it is a reference to that web page. So for example, if you ask like, how old is he? Without any context, it doesn't know what that means, but provided that you have a web page already loaded up, it'll look for the answer there. And that I think just makes the whole experience a little more seamless. I also explain that the contents of the web page will be in workflow.searchResult. That will not be the case if you haven't scraped anything, as we just saw with the example earlier, which is why it was asking us for a web page. And now the last part is basically I tell it how to open up the dialogue. I say, upon receiving this information, please send a message to the user that summarizes the contents of the web page in a single sentence and invites the user to ask questions about the content. I made a point of telling it to be brief and then to also use one sentence here, because I find that it can get very cluttered in this little UI, and the whole point of this is to be able to extract information. Now the $1 million question here is, how do we ensure that this all happens in the same chat? As in, we send a message to the bot and it triggers this flow, and then we tell this node over here to send a message back, but there isn't necessarily an indication of which conversation this happens in. The answer to all that is that we have to indicate in the webhook event the conversation ID, and then that will make sure that we enter the appropriate conversation. Now, the conversation ID is passed in the event.payload.body.conversationId. We'll go back to the logs for a second. Here is what the webhook API call looks like. And over here, we have the conversation ID. So that value is accessed when we want to return text to the user. And now I'm going to show you a second flow, which doesn't rely on the Botpress browse pages actions and instead relies on the scraping that's done inside your browser extension and the Botpress files and knowledge. So I'm going to hook these up here. When we get a webhook event, we save it to a variable called page content. It has basically all the values that the webhook event has. Now what happens is we go over to this autonomous node. So you'll receive webhook events. It'll be stored in page content. Check the website data table to verify whether this URL has been scraped. If not, transition to the upsert KB flow to insert the data in workflow.pageContent into the table. What is that table? It is a table that stores all the information because we want to be able to perform RAG later. So it has, you know, the basic stuff like the URL and domain. I am not crazy about this method, and this is a shorthand for another method that I mentioned earlier in the video, which is where you make full files, you chunk it down into appropriate sizes, and then you perform proper indexing on all those files. This is going to be a topic for another video because it's kind of a lot to get into right now. But in essence, the idea is that in the future, you can check whether or not you've already scraped, that URL, and you could either update it, as in destroy everything that existed before, or you could add a new row. The reason you would add a new row, even if you've already scraped it, is because, you know, websites can change and update, which can happen over time, like a Wikipedia page gets edited. It can also happen in a dynamic, reactive website. So in these instructions, as you saw, I said to check whether or not it's already been added to the table. So let me back up a little bit to explain how everything works in this flow. So in the event that it receives this webhook event, it takes the page content, which stores all the data from the web page, and then it basically fills out all these variables that are getting passed to the upsert KB workflow. So we go here, we grab this entry variable. By the way, if you're looking for how to add an entry variable, you create your variable here. It's got to be a workflow variable, by the way. You click on the entry node. This is not activated. Now it is activated. So what happens is it moves over to this execute code card. Now what I have to do is truncate the data, because we can upload at most 4 kilobytes at a time per row. And then we call the tables API and upload the page content and then make a new row. Those values are added, and then we return back to the main flow. And we have a search knowledge card. This lets us access information in the knowledge base at any given turn. Send a message to the user that summarizes the contents and invites the user to ask further questions. In some instances, you may want to check whether other pages under the same domain have been scraped. As you saw before, we keep the domain also of the scraped page. So not just wikipedia.org/whatever, but wikipedia.org in general, which means we can cross-reference that with other Wikipedia pages. Not necessarily terribly helpful in this case, but imagine you're scraping information on a site and you want to check another page. You know, what is the return policy of this website? Then it goes, well, we don't have that over here, but maybe we scraped another page from this site earlier and we're able to cross-reference with that information. Also, if you're trying to create this knowledge base for yourself and have this web of different resources that you want to cross-reference, this is a great use case for that. What I'm going to do, in fact, is also hold this URL, because when we transition to other workflows, we might lose the workflow.page content, but I want to be able to remind this bot at any given point in the conversation which URL we're working with so that we can look again in the knowledge base. Okay, so now I'll say something to the model about conditioning its answers based on information in the knowledge base. All right, we'll see what happens. Filling in on what I did here is I created a conversation.url variable that will persist across different workflows. Even when we transition into upsert KB and then come back into the main one. The reason for that is because at any given point, if the information from the Wikipedia page falls too far behind in the conversation context for the LLM to remember certain details, it could always pull up that information again from the table, and it'll find the right row by cross-referencing it with the URL that's being held in conversation.url. Let's publish it and see how it works. What was his first movie? Cool. The information does not specify if this was his absolute first film. I think that that is incredibly transparent, and that's exactly the way I want to see it. And by the way, that's what you see here, The Curious Case of Benjamin Button. And it did not mention the short film. I guess, I don't know, that's a certain amount of incredibly obscure bias. Anyway, this is everything that you need to get the extension installed and to configure Botpress to be able to interface with it. All right, next steps. What are ways to expand on this? You can iterate through the data in chunks and break it down so that when the user asks a question about a specific item, the bot can access it in a more structured way. For example, you can break down dates, you can use bullet points to break down the contents of a news article or a Wikipedia page or something. It also might be a better idea to use the files API to upload files based on the scraped data and then use the knowledge base to access those files. You also might want to keep a table cross-referencing URLs and domains with the data that you scrape. That's actually a good idea, and I might go do that before I publish this video. Anyway, think of this as your blank canvas. So go crazy and make sure you tell us what you build. Until then, happy bot building.